Let's see how to do math and science, preserving the correct sig figs and thus the measurement precision throughout the computation. First, we will do sig fig addition and subtraction. The rule is that the result of an addition-subtraction computation will have the same number of decimal places as the value in the computation that has the fewest decimal places. For example, let's add three measurements. The measurement with the least number of decimal places is the 4.2 value and the least precise number. If each of these values had the units of mass, such as grams, the 4.2 value must have been the one measured on the least precise balance. This value dictates the precision of the computation and where we need to round off the calculated result. In this case, that will be the tenths position, leading to a result of 1025.2. To summarize this very important concept, the final result of this computation now accurately represents the precision of all the measurements in the computation, a result which should be limited by the weakest link in the computational chain, the 4.2 value, the number which must have been measured on the least precise instrument. For multiplication and division math, the result of this calculation will have the same number of significant figures as the value in the computation with the fewest number of significant digits. In the computation shown, we are going to do a multiplication-division calculation with three values. Utilizing the rule, we identify the value 6.2 as the one with the least number of sig figs, 2. Thus, the result must have 2 sig figs. But if we write it as simply 1700, after rounding off to the hundreds position, our answer will be ambiguous, and others won't be able to know that it only has 2 sig figs. But as we know, the number becomes unambiguous if we represent the result in scientific notation, 1.7 times 10 to the third, which now clearly reflects a value having 2 sig figs. Why does the multiplication and division rule differ from the addition and subtraction one? The explanation is not quite as intuitive as the addition and subtraction rule, but I'll try to give you a sense of why the rule reads the way it does. Unlike addition and subtraction, the measurement math of multiplication and division depends on the relative size of the number with respect to its absolute error. This is called the relative error, and we get it when we take the absolute error and divide by the magnitude of the number itself. Now, we don't know the absolute error of these numbers here exactly, but we can get a rough estimate of them. The absolute error of the 6.2 value in the computation must be in the tenths position, because we always assume that last value contains the uncertainty of the measurement. So we can estimate the range of the error to be from 0.1 to 0.9. Now, if we take both the high and low value of the error and divide by the 6.2 value and then multiply by 100 to get it into a percentage, we can estimate the error to lie between 2 to 14% probably. In other words, the error in the measurement is a rather large percentage of the number itself and could be as high as 14%. But for the value 1017.222, we have a number with a greater number of sig figs and a number with a tiny, tiny error in comparison to the magnitude of the number itself. Here, we can assume the absolute error to be in the range of 0.001 to 0.009. The relative error, then, is assumed to be in the range between 1 times 10 to the minus 4th and 1 times 10 to the minus 3rd percent, significantly smaller than the 6.2 value. Now, if we do this kind of analysis for each of the values in the computation, for 3.765, we would obtain a relative error greater than that for our 1017.222 value, but less than the 6.2 value. Now, go ahead and prove that to yourself. Now, here is the point. In multiplication and division, the number with the greatest relative error is the weakest link in the measurement and the computational chain. the number with the smallest number of sig figs is assumed to be the number with the greatest relative error. So it will be this number that dictates the error and will determine where we must round off our final value in a multiplication and division computation. You noticed that we had to round off values for most of our computations, so maybe we should review our round off rules. First, we keep the number if the last digit we're going to drop is less than 5. So if we want to round off 5.623 to the tenths place, we see that 0.023 is less than 0.050. So we keep the 6, rounding the number to 5.6. Now we round up if the last digit we are going to drop is greater than 5. If we want to round off 5.673 to the tenths place, the 0.073 is greater than 0.05, so we round up the number to 5.7. A tricky example is rounding off a value like 5.653 to the tenths place. Well, 0.053 is still greater than 0.050, so we round up following our second rule. So the correct number is 5.7. This brings up the most confusing example in the rule for rounding that we have. What do we do if the last digit we want to drop is exactly 5? For example, what if we want to round off 5.65 to the tenths place? We now see that 0.05 is exactly in the middle of the value 5.6 and 5.7. Most introductory textbooks follow the rule that if the last digit we're going to drop is exactly equal to 5, then round up. Utilizing this rule, we would round the number to 5.7. For most of what we do, we will use this rounding rule. Now, the following is just for your information, but it's a much more robust and rigorous method of rounding numbers. For really precise analytical work with several samples and calculations that need rounding, there's a problem with rounding off the way we just described in the previous example. If we treated a whole series of these kinds of numbers in this exact way, every time rounding up, statistically, at the end of the series of multiple computations, we would be overstating the results, accumulating what we term as round-off error. It would be best if 50% of the time we rounded up and 50% of the time we rounded down when we have this condition. I guess we could flip a coin to determine if we round up or down, but that seems a bit weird to use a coin doing scientific work. So in high-value analytical chemistry, we use a nice compromise. For intense analytical work, many use a rounding rule for fives called the banking rule. If the last digit we're going to drop is exactly equal to 5, then we round to the nearest even number every time. We're assuming that when rounding 50% of the time, we would get even values. Using this rule, rounding off 5.65 to the tenths place would round the number to 5.6, keeping the last number as an even value. Now, if the number were 5.75, we would round up to 5.8, again, rounding to the nearest even value. Okay, it's time to figure out what we will do if faced with a computation that has both addition, subtraction, and multiplication division calculations within it. Before we face mixed operation computations, let's review the mathematical rules for the order of operations. When we have parentheses, we do calculations within the parentheses first. Exponentials, which are numbers to a power and also include logarithmic numbers, which are special forms of exponentials, are done next, followed by multiplication division calculations, and finally, we finish with addition subtraction computations. Before jumping right into a mixed computation example, we need to establish a very, very critical rule that has to be followed. We will not round off any number until the very end of a multi-step computation. Okay, I'm going to say it again. We will not round off any number in a mixed computation or multi-step problem until the very end. That being said, we want to carefully keep track of where we would have rounded off a number in the intermittent steps, but instead of rounding them off, we will underline where the critical last significant figure should be in the number computed in the intermittent step. Let's do an example of a mixed computation. First, we do the calculation within the parentheses obtaining 0.379, not rounding off, but marking the significant digit of the computation, the number 7, because the least precise value in this computation was 5.11, and the final error of the particular computation should be in the hundredths place if we stopped at this computation. Now we do the division and obtain 15.6121, underlining the 5 value in the ones position because we are essentially dividing by a number, the 0.379 value from the previous step, which has 2 significant digits. We finish up with the final subtraction, obtaining the number -8.8121. The least precise quantity in the subtraction is the 15.6121 value, where the 5 is underlined, reminding us that we can only measure this value to the ones position, and thus we must underline the first 8 in the final result. Finally, it's time to round off, so we round up, obtaining the result -9, or better still, -9 times 10 to the 0, to stay clear of any ambiguity in the sig figs. We now have a result that incorporates the correct error after considering all the error in all the other values. For those new to this kind of math, this might seem like a ton of info to take in and remember. That being said, just think about how many calculations like these we'll do in chemistry. And for every calculation, we are expected to do them in this manner, every time, preserving the integrity of the measurement and the magnitude of its error. Believe me, all of this will become second nature, okay? We'll catch you later.